All right, well then we'll go ahead and get started. We're going to start with Alive and Breathing. Message and how God equips us as he gives us his word. And this next song is entitled Ancient Words, and how foundational and how constructive they are in our lives. Something we can always fall back on. It's always solid, always secure. He's always the rock. And it's going to take our energy level in a different direction as we move now to focus on his word.
Ancient words, long preserved for our walk in this world, they resound with God's own word.
prayer as we continue. Almighty and eternal God, your Son, Jesus Christ, he triumphed over the prince of demons, and he freed us from the bondage of sin. We know that because of his word revealed to us. Equip us this morning to stand firm against every assault of Satan. Enable us always to do your will, for you have called us to this place. You've imparted us this knowledge. You've given us your spirit. And now, Lord, equipped with that, we ask that you would have your way with us, so that we do and act as you've called us to do. We pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. He lives, he reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
So, we are moving forward. We started out with this guiding statement, a beacon of the community, equipping, empowering, and sharing the hope and love of Jesus. We came up with these massive pillars, engage, equip, empower, and shine. We've created targets and goals and tasks, and that's all going to be revealed as we draw closer and closer to the 30th. Underneath every single pillar stands the Word of God. A foundational verse that was drawn from Scripture that supports what's going on. The writer of Hebrews, after the whole book was written, at the very end, ends with what some even use as a benediction or a sending or a blessing. This is the anchor verse for equip. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. The Hebrew writer spoke those words. He set them up by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and they have been built one upon the other. Jesus is brought to life by God the Father, the great shepherd of the sheep, marked, secured, guaranteed by the blood of the covenant of Jesus Christ. All of those things, God, Father, Son, and Spirit now to equip you with all that you need to do with what God has called you to do. Nothing can bar God working to you. Nothing can stop his love from seeking you out and continuing to be lavishly poured upon you. Oftentimes we don't always see that in response, though. Oftentimes we see ourselves and we look in the mirror and we say, somehow we've moved so far away from God that even God can't reach us. Well, if you're in that place right now this morning, if you're finding yourselves kind of at a loss, you need to turn to God and ask for forgiveness. And so God is there as a wonderful Father in heaven, waiting, anticipating you to tell him exactly what you need to tell him, and confess exactly what you need to confess. I'm going to lead us in a time of confession now, but you have your time. You have your moment. For some, it'll seem really a long time, and for some, it just may seem too short, but we're going to give it some time where you can actually itemize those sins, those doubts, those sincere points of regret, and lay them at the foot of the cross. So let's pray. God, we understand from your word that sin causes our troubles. It causes us to doubt, to fear. Sin is even the cause of death. And for this reason, you sent your Son to be our Savior. And he took upon himself the sin of the world. He paid the debt for my sin. Yet it seems like I, just like Paul, my sin is ever before me. I've been too greedy, too selfish, too spontaneous with quick words that often cut people down instead of building them up. I've taken things that I shouldn't take. I've torn people down. And I am sorry. I'm sorry for the sins of my thoughts when other people don't even know what's going on, yet you know everything. And I'm sorry for the sins of my actions and for my inactions and when you called me by the Holy Spirit to do something and I refused. So I implore you now that you would hear my confession, hear our confession, hear each person in this room's confession as they now quietly and from their heart to the foot of the cross confess those sins ask for forgiveness, a truly desire to turn from and repent from them. Hear them now in Jesus' name. For unjust anger, being overly critical, failing to put you first, always. Not coming to worship like I'm supposed to. Not worshiping when I'm here like I'm supposed to. Veiling concern when you're really being critical. Taking things I shouldn't have taken. Whether it's time or possessions. Help me to be more patient. Help me to be more full of grace. Help me to give mercy because I received it. I'm truly sorry for our sins. I sincerely confess and acknowledge them to you. I desire your forgiveness, and I desire, Lord, that you would send your Spirit, give you the power to overcome them, to turn from them, and to amend my life, so that it's more in line with you. Equip me, Lord. You've given me the tools. You've given me the Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. God is faithful and just. He will sincerely hear your confession, and he will forgive you. In the name of my Lord Jesus Christ, as a called and ordained servant, your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God's people said,
amen.
Let's pass the peace and joy of Jesus now as we celebrate being forgiven children of God. I think there's music on that slide. Sun shining. It's a beautiful day, but I need to make sure that Carter is equipped for what's about to take place here, all right?
All right.
So I've got some things here that are ready to equip you. Here we go.
All right. Okay. Here we go. Let's see here. I need you to put this on, okay? Thank you very much. Very good here. All right.
Head on. Get a scarf on because it's dirty. There we go. All right. Got to get this coat on next. All right.
All right. Here we go. Come on. All right. We got the gloves happening here.
Yeah.
All right. Here's the other one. All right. Do you think he looks ready?
Yeah.
He is equipped.
He is equipped.
He's equipped for what?
Winter.
You're equipped for winter. But it's not winter outside. But if you were to get ready for winter, you would put on hats, you'd put on a scarf, you'd put on a coat. I didn't bring my boots, although I did think about the boots. And I thought, no, we won't have time for that. Thank you. That's being equipped for everything that you need to be equipped for. You can take that off. It's important to be equipped because what God has us ready to do. And some of the things that we use to be equipped are like what we just had here. We had coats to get ready. This morning, I was ready for church. I got dressed. I was all cleaned up. I had all the stuff ready to go. And I got into my vehicle and I left. And I left and I turned right. Then I turned right again. And I turned left. And I remember, uh-oh, I forgot something. So I turned around. I came all the way back. Mrs. Pate, she was there, she was sitting in her chair, and all of a sudden she hears the truck, and she goes, uh-oh, I'll bet. Sure enough, I left this at home. Like, oh no, my computer was in here, my sermon was in here, all the stuff was in here. I remembered my coat. I remembered that, but I forgot this. I wasn't equipped. Now, we need to have the things that we need. We need to have our coats, we need to have our stuff so that we're ready. When you go to school, what are some of the things you use for school? Backpacks and pencils and paper, right? And
uniform.
You have uniform, all those things for school. You have to be equipped to do that. We're talking about being ready for what God has for us to do. Now, what do you think God wants you to do? God probably wants you to tell others about God. Probably wants you to tell others, but are you equipped to do that? I think it's important when you come to church or when you go home at home that your parents, your grandparents, or your pastor, or your church helps you to be equipped to go and tell someone. And so I have something to give you so that you're equipped to go and tell somebody something. Okay? I have it over here. All right? In here, I have a wonderful message. What's one message you'd like to tell someone about Jesus? What would you say? Yeah?
Jesus loves you.
That's awesome because, you know what? That's what I have on this piece of paper. It says, for God so loved the world. That means not just you, but the whole world, but especially you, that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not die, but will have eternal life. And I've got one for all of you, so you're going to be equipped to give it to somebody else, to say God loves you. But I think it's important that when you give one of these out, that you might need to have something sweet to go along with it. Don't you think so? I think so. All right, so let's ask God to help us be equipped and tell others that God loves them. Ready? Let's have a prayer. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for equipping me.
Thank you for equipping me.
Help me to tell others
about your love.
All right, so you come on up, and I will give you two of them and one of these. The sweets for you, okay? Here you go.
Thank you.
Yes. You know, one thing I've learned about the equipping process is just because someone's equipped doesn't always mean that they're going to go and do something. I think there's a lot of people in the world today, a lot of people in our church today, that they may feel like, oh, they're equipped, but then they don't go and do what God calls them to do. Would you pray with me? Lord, open up my lips that I may speak your word. Open up my heart that I may hear it. Open up our lives, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, so that we will act and do according to your good and gracious will. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I believe that our society is becoming increasingly more fragmented, in which people seem more separated from one another. And I think that's why it's important that the church stands as a refuge. And it's more than a refuge. It's more than a building, isn't it? On Sunday morning, we come together. It's more than a meeting. It's more than just an organization. I think it's a community. And I see that over and over again, every single week and throughout the week when I come to this place in the world, this piece of property, and when I see in the public square or out in the world. It's a community where people come together, this place, a place where everyone, not just the pastor, cares about each other. It's a place where every person matters. I think St. Peter's is a place that aspires to be the beacon of the community, equipping, empowering, and sharing the hope and love of Jesus. It's a community anew, maybe renewed is a good topic or a good label. We're not just hoping for a new community here at St. Peter's. No, we're actually taking practical steps to make it a reality. We're developing a process that will result that the body of Christ will be equipped to do what new community, new churches, new people in Christ are supposed to do. And I just want to give you a little idea of, you know, where this came from. Not just that it happened to come from the guiding statement and come from the material that the congregation, by the Holy Spirit, has kind of helped us mold and come to some sort of consensus. But I came up with a question, actually in my study, quite many years ago. And here was the question. It was a question to God. It was like this. God, if you're to give us, and I mean this family of believers, if you were to give St. Peter's a new believer who showed the interest and desire for spiritual growth, what process, what opportunities do we have in place that will equip that person to grow to a healthy and more balanced relationship with Jesus? That was the question. And since then, I've discovered that it's not just new believers that need this process, need this equipping. It's believers who have been believers for almost all of their lives. It's something essential for everyone's spiritual life. And so, with our key word being equipped, the operative phrase then is equipping the saints to do the work of the ministry. Now, I looked up definitions for the word equipped, and there's quite a few of them. One definition for the word equipped is to provide yourself or somebody something with the things that are needed for a particular purpose or activity. So you're providing. So that's someone that is giving out something to someone else so that they're ready for a purpose or an activity. Go out for winter, go play in the snow. Or maybe it's go to the beach. You got flip-flops and sunscreen. You know, whatever it is, you're giving them the tools, something to equip them to do it. Another definition is to prepare someone for an activity or task, especially by teaching them what they need to know. Now, some of us are great at taking a lesson that we've been taught, whether, you know, and it may not be an object lesson, but it's something that someone spoke to us and applying it to our lives. Sometimes I wish I was much better at that. But you're going to be given gifts. The Word of God is going to speak to you today. The Spirit's going to move in your hearts today. And something's going to happen. And perhaps it'll be an equipping for you to do something. Or it'll give you something that you need to know. And the third definition is to supply whatever gear or apparatus is needed to use for any undertaking. You're going to fill out like it says here, a ship or an army. A lot of synonyms. And some of them work for some, and some work for others, and some don't work at all. To adorn someone with something, some gifts, might be a definition of equip. And I'm going to just kind of shotgun these out at you. We're going to arm someone. We're going to deck them out or decorate. Dress it for the occasion. Endow someone. Furnish, gear, prepare. Provide, qualify, rig, set up, supply. Lots of words for equip. And we use them because we want someone to be equipped. And now God equips us, and I'm going to go with three main ways how God equips us. The fourth one would be by others, by the fellowship of believers. But the main three ways that I'm going to be talking about are first and foremost His Word. The Word of God, the same Word that says, let there be light, that has power. The Word of God that we should never really minimize. I think too often, and I'm probably guilty of this too, we minimize God's powerful word. I mean, these children were given little slips of paper with John 3:16 on them. They're going to go out and they're going to tell someone that God loves them. I have no idea what impact it's going to make on every single person, but I know the potential of the impact that can have on someone. And that's what God's word does for you and I. Now, I've read you the one from Hebrews, which is that founding one. If you have your Bibles open, I encourage you to open them up because I would love you to circle it or highlight it or mark it down or somehow draw attention to it. Every time you're flipping through your Bible and you look at Hebrews and you happen to get to Hebrews 13, you go, oh, I marked that. Why did I mark that? And I think it really makes a difference. It does for me when I'm going through my Bible. Oftentimes I go down the rabbit hole or a squirrel hole, as a friend of mine used to say, and I digress from what my past was, but then I find my way back. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, who rose His Son from the dead. He's the great shepherd of the sheep. Covenant by His blood. Equip you. That you will do His will, that which is working in us, pleasing in His sight. When you love someone, you want to serve them. You want to provide for them. You want to care for them. You want to please them. You want them to prosper and grow. And I find this in the world today. You see those relationships. When someone admires somebody else and they're called to either speak about them or to serve in their name or to do something for them, they're on a whole different level than someone else who's just doing it because. And I think this is really possible when we realize how much God loves us. The next passage actually comes from Psalm 145. It's King David, and he's writing, and this is the one that many of us use when we're going to have food. The eyes of all look to You, give them their food in due season, right? We have that prayer before we eat. David was speaking about a grander vision. You open Your hand, You satisfy the desires of every living thing, equipping us with everything that we need. Everything. He will equip us. Now, many of you know the famous passage, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. But what comes before it is Matthew chapter 6. Another one, if you've got your Bibles open, to circle it and open up and say, oh, I never realized that. Or it really is drawn attention to it. Jesus was speaking to the disciples and he was talking about how the Gentiles are looking at all kinds of things. And they're always seeking after certain things. And he wanted to assure the people that were listening to him. He says, for the Gentiles seek after all these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. Your Heavenly Father knows you need them all. Now, we still request, why do we ask stuff in Jesus' name? Because He wants to be in conversation with us. But He knows what we need. I've come to pray more and more the prayer that's more open-minded and open-ended to God. I will say something like, dear Lord, You love them more than I love them. You care about them more than I can possibly care, even though they're my own family. Please do what's best for them. And I let it go. He knows. And I found solace in that prayer. because I'd like to solve problems. I'd like to seek the solutions and make it all happen. But when I can't, or the times that I've tried have failed, I've learned that He is the giver of all good things and already knows. So He's going to provide all that for us. Now, Tom, I can't quite remember if I hit into John yet or not yet. It is? Okay. I wanted to read to you from the book of John, John 14. And here's another, I told you we're going to be emphasizing His word. John chapter 14, this is the time when Jesus is about to leave His disciples. And it's, I'm going to paraphrase, I'm not going to read through it all, but I'll move through it fairly quickly because I want to get to kind of the climax of the passage. Jesus is saying that if you love Him, you're going to keep His commandments. Kind of like if you love a parent, you love someone in authority, you're going to obey, you're going to do what they want, you're going to care about them. And Jesus is pointing that out to His disciples. He says, if you love Me, you'll keep My commandments, and I'll ask the Father. He'll give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees Him nor knows Him, but you know Him, for He dwells with you and will be in you. This is a paradigm shift. This is a game changer that most, if not all of you sitting here today already realized that the Spirit of God lives in you. That you have God's help during times of trouble and need. You've got it. This is John 14, right there, right? 15 and 16. But He says, I'm going to send you the Spirit. The world doesn't know this. And that's all time for another message, another sermon. It's almost incomprehensible that the world just not only doesn't understand Jesus, but just doesn't even isn't able to know Him. But the world can't receive it because they don't see Him or know Him. You have. And then He goes, I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I'm going to come to you. I'm going to leave, but I'm going to send someone. And at the very end of the passage, it says, these things I have spoken to you while I'm still with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in My name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you. And you have pastors that bring you to remembrance when he quotes this passage or talks about this miracle and says that He still loves you very much. And if you were the only one in the world, He would die for you. And you have parents that cradle you in your arms and tell you how much Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. And they lead lives. You have all of these things happening, teaching you to remind you of all the things that God has done. And you know that the Holy Spirit's there to strengthen you and help you. God's word is extremely powerful. I once read a job application. It's quite long. It was an application for a minister for a church. A minister for the church. And I will not read it all to you, but it goes on and says, here's the description of the person that we're looking for. We need someone who's is as experienced as a shop worker, an office manager, an educator on all levels, an artist, a diplomat, a writer, a theologian, a politician. It goes on to say the person has to know all about problems from birth, marriage, to death, must know all the practices, just like pediatrics and doctors know. They have to be good at nuclear science. They have to be good at economics. The right man will hold firm views on every single topic, but also be careful not to upset anyone who has a difference of opinion. They'll pretend to enjoy people listening to people. Well, I don't know about that one. They'll educate. They'll have what most PhDs have as requirements under their belt. They have to be willing to work long hours. It goes on to say that the wife of such an applicant needs to love working in the kitchen, willing to teach classes, willing to babysit, never willing to gossip, never becoming discouraged, and always willing to lend a helping hand in worship. And what struck me about this particular description is for the most part, it's not a description of what a pastor is supposed to be necessarily. It's a description of what seems to be the expectations of just about any minister. We're to care. We're to love. We're not to draw conclusions. We're to be hospitable. And so what we have today is this relationship that if someone were to ask you, who is or are the ministers of St. Peter Lutheran Church, you'd say, we all are. We're all ministers of St. Peter's. God has called us all of us to do what he's called us to do. We are the faithful. We're the ones that are brought to the place where we're supposed to do work. We're to be the beacons. We're to be the sharing, the empowering, the equipping, and so forth. And God has enabled us to do it with his word. The other thing that he equips us with are his sacraments. Now, most of the time, 99% of the time, when I ask what people are receiving when they come up to receive the sacraments, they tell me different things. The first one, I ask, what about baptism? And they say, well, baptism, I think you're being brought into God's family and you're with water. Well, what baptism actually does, it says in Galatians chapter 3, it says, for in Jesus Christ you're all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Again, more equipping. If you don't walk away feeling like you heard about equipping today, I don't know what else I could say. In 1 Corinthians 5, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. The baptism is the drowning of the old self, the new man or woman rising and living before God in righteousness and purity forever. That's who you are. That's your identity. Not the person you always sometimes see in the mirror. You're a redeemed child of God, loved and redeemed by Christ the Crucified. When people come up to the Lord's table, I say, what do you get? They say, bread and wine, or body and blood. I said, what else do you get? They say, forgiveness of sins. And they're right. They're absolutely spot on. But we also know that as Christ gives us victory over sin and Satan in the sacrament, he also strengthens us for a new life. I'm a profound believer, even though you don't necessarily feel it. I remember, as far as feeling communion, feeling the sacrament have an effect. I remember one confirmand, after they had their first communion, we met later to have a time of prayer and gathering together after the service. And she pulled me aside and said, I don't feel any different. I said, what do you mean? Well, I didn't feel like any tingling or any special like zap of God when I was up there. I said, but did anything happen there? She goes, yeah. I had Jesus in me and he forgave me and all the blessings that I get, because she was confirmand, she was telling me the answer. But just because you don't necessarily feel the zing and the zap, it doesn't annul the fact that something more is happening up there. Forgiveness of sins, life and salvation. And when you go out in that world, you are guarded, you are strengthened, and that's equipped. In 1 Peter 2, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds we've been healed. His death was our death. His life is our death. We have this newness of life. You and I are equipped. So let me tell you, in conclusion, what I believe so strongly, what I know about our church. I know that St. Peter Luther needs to become the fully functioning, equipping church. And I want everyone you to know what your spiritual mix is, the gifts that God's given you, where you can enjoy serving God and know that what you do is in communion with other believers together. I want you to know what it's like to have a satisfying devotional life. I want you to be able to explain why you have the Christian faith that you have. I want you to be able to know and understand and how to develop relationships with other people. How to lead a life in the marketplace. Lead an exemplary life when you're out in the world. I want you to know how to build a strong family. I want you to know how to be a servant leader. I want you to know how to develop positive attitudes in life. I want you to know how to bring some of the faith by sharing your faith. I want you to know how to read the big picture of what God is doing in this world and to be able to accept it and to have yourself in the strong and loving arms of Jesus. When all this stuff happening, we come together in worship and we get together and we celebrate and we strengthen and we engage. but that we become a more effective worker for the Lord as he's called us. And finally, Paul said, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly in my weakness, so that the power of Christ may rest on me. Oh, I say amen to that. It's all about God working through me. And he desires to work for each and every one of you. In the strong and precious name of Jesus, I pray this. Amen. Amen. And my prayer is, this is exactly the way you want to live. And so our song is a song prayer that I'm asking you to stand. It's called Live Like That. And we'll do that before we have the offering and the message from the elder. Sometimes I think, what would people say of me when I'm only just a memory? When I'm home, where my soul belongs, was I loved when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song? I wanna live like that. go ahead and have a seat and invite the elder to come up to this time.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Let's try it again. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Much better. All right, today's message for the elders comes from 1 Kings chapter 17, and we'll be looking at, you can bust out the Bible if you want. We'll be looking at verses 8 through 15, but I'm just going to paraphrase it. God sent Elijah to Zarephath, okay, and he said, go, there'll be a widow there that'll meet you, and she's going to take care of you. So he was obedient, he went. There was a widow there, and she was picking up sticks, collecting sticks. And he says to her, hey, go get me some water. So she takes off to go get water. He goes, hold on, bring me some bread, too. And she's like, I haven't even baked anything for the day. That's what the sticks are for. And he goes, that's okay. Go home. Bake some bread up. Bring it to me. She goes, but I only have a little flour and a little oil. He says, be faithful, be obedient, and she was. And guess what? The jar with the flour never went empty, and the oil never went dry. Now, those kind of miracles, we probably don't see those every day, do we? It's not like I go in the pantry and the sugar never runs out. Right off. And I'm like, I don't know, every time I go, more sugar. Okay. But we do see miracles every day, and we don't know how just a little act of obedience by ourselves is going to grow God's kingdom. So, you know, we give. This month, I had to put a new hot water heater in. Okay? That wasn't an expense I was planning on, all right? And that delayed the truck payment, which delayed other things, and it also, we're like, oh man, we're not going to be able to give as much as we normally give at that week at church. You know what? We still made what we could make, and we were obedient. You never know how your $1 that you get, maybe it's your last dollar, all right? And payday's coming up, and you're like, all right, I'll give my last dollar. I've got enough gas in the tank, and I've got enough food in the pantry, and the sugar never runs out. And you get, and you're obedient. God's just asking you, I don't need millions of dollars. I need faithful, obedient people that give and love from their heart. So as you get ready to give your tithes and offerings today, just remember that $1, if that's all you've got, you never know on this side of the kingdom. We may never know how God used that dollar. So be faithful, trust in God, and be obedient.
You can come up with your offering. I'm also here if you'd like to have a little prayer. Jesus' name, we return to you just some of the first fruits that you've given to us. We ask that we put you first in all things, that you would receive these and they would just grow your kingdom, that others would come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you that you continue to watch over us and you provide us this wonderful place, this wonderful created world. You've also given us your holy church,
So we ask, Lord, that you would be with your church, be with the community of St. Peter Lutheran, and be with pastors and other leaders, that they would continue to proclaim and realize the wonderful joy of the hope of the resurrection. I ask, Lord, that you would watch over the world, especially those that are going through some turmoil and trial. We lift them up to you and ask for peace to come down upon them. There be a peaceful resolution of what's going on. We lift up our own nation and ask that we would not lose heart with worldly and earthly troubles, but to endure, realizing that you love us so very much. In the midst of trials and troubles, anxieties and sicknesses, and even maybe the fear of death, we ask for comfort and healing for those that are struggling with illnesses. For Beth Underwood in the hospital, Kirk Bowie, who's recovering from heart surgery, and others, Lord, that are needing extra peace and mercy during this time. Bless them, Lord, and bring us as ministers of healing to them, especially during this time of need. Lord, we also want to give you thanks for the faithful believers who have gone before us. Help us to remember those who have fought a good fight and finished the race. And help us that one day we too will, with our heavenly goal in mind, receive that wonderful reward for our faithfulness. I thank you, Lord, that we've got little ones and older ones that are praying for others. And I pray for the Holy Spirit to descend upon each and every one here today. And for all of the people that are needing your love, we know that you long for them and desire them. So we ask that as they hear the Holy Spirit knocking on their hearts, they would answer. And they would know that is the case. If we prepare ourselves to receive the body and blood of Jesus, we ask, Lord, that we would do so faithfully, believing in your word, given and shed for the forgiveness of sins, and having faith that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, not with an unrepentant heart, but one that comes fully acknowledging our sin and our need for forgiveness, so that by it we would receive the hope that is ours in salvation, and we would also receive that strength that we need as we carry out our lives. Help us, Lord, to be equipped. We pray this in the strong and precious name of Jesus. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Knowing that Christ died our death, and his rising to new life is our life, as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We say, Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. We also remind ourselves of our entire faith as we pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. We'll be praying the Lord's Prayer in song, and you're encouraged to please stand. He is our Father in heaven. His name is holy and hallowed, and his kingdom is his forever. Let your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done, on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come, Father, let your will be done.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let the people come. It's yours, all yours, the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours.
Table of the King.
Please stand for a prayer.
Thanks.
Father God, you love us even though we don't deserve your love. You withhold the punishment we deserve because of your great love, and so we receive your mercy. And in your love and mercy, we give you thanks for the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, in this sacrament. You equip us already to live that eternal life in unity with all the company of heaven. And we give you thanks and praise. We ask now that you would help us to live our lives as your children all the days of our lives until you call us and we enter that fullness of the resurrection. We pray this through our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. He lives and he rules and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor. Give you his peace.
Amen.
Make me so, make me alive. Let your
sacrament and the Spirit. You're equipped.